Welcome to the Spy Collection Digital Edition, where we are looking at spy artifacts that only exist in digital format. My name is Anastasios and today's artifact comes from 2018. Our story starts just a couple of days after the Kerch Strait incident, which took place on November 25th, 2018. What happened was that Ukrainian Navy vessels attempted to pass from the Black Sea into the Sea of Azov through the Kerch Strait. The Russian Coast Guard forces of the main internal security agency, the FSB, detected them, attempted to stop them, opened fire, and eventually captured all three of them. Of course, this was just a single event in a series of escalations that were happening around that time between the two nation states, Ukraine and Russia. How does this relate to our spy artifact, though? Just 4 days later, on November 29th of 2018, cybersecurity firm Qihoo 360 detected an advanced cyber-espionage operation targeting the FSBI Polyclinic No. 2, and according to several intelligence analysts, it was likely a cyber-espionage operation originating from Ukraine. I'd like to stress that, while this is filmed, there is no conclusive evidence to attribute the cyber-espionage operation to a specific nation-state. The attribution of it to Ukraine is based on intelligence assessments of the most likely hypothesis. But what was this FSBI Polyclinic No. 2? The full name of that is Federal State Budgetary Institution Polyclinic No. 2 of the Administrative Department of the President of the Russian Federation, and it's a medical institution mainly for high-ranked civil servants, government executives of the legislative, judicial authorities of the Russian Federation, as well as other high-profile figures. It's not clear what information the cyber operators wanted to extract from this institution, but medical information on government officials and their families is an exceptionally common target of intelligence agencies, mainly because it can help them identify vulnerabilities in people to recruit. For example, help them with a family member with serious medical issues, blackmail them if they are addicted to illegal substances, and other similar ways. However, in this case, we do not know the intention behind the operation, since it was disrupted before it reached this stage. So what happened? On the evening of November 29th, some employees of this Russian institution started receiving a carefully crafted employee questionnaire over email, exactly like the one you see here. The questionnaire was sent as a RAR file archive, and in there was a Microsoft Word document with a fake questionnaire. In this RAR file, there was also another file named scan042.jpg, but despite its deceiving JPEG file extension, it wasn't an image file. It was a software implant, a backdoor the cyber operators could use to control the victim's system. When the unwitting victim tried to open this questionnaire, Microsoft Word would try to load an embedded SWF program. That is a program using the Adobe Flash framework. Thus, it would ask the user if they want to execute it or not. Here is how this question looked like. If the victim clicked to not authorize the Flash code of the questionnaire to play, nothing would happen. However, if they clicked on allow to play, then they are in a bad situation. In that case, in the background, the program would extract the scan042.jpg from the RAR archive to the local file system and rename it to backup.exe. Then this specially crafted Flash code wasn't just executing some simple commands, it was taking advantage of a previously unknown security flaw in Flash framework itself. Up to this cyber espionage operation, that wasn't known to the vendor or anyone else in the public domain. This makes it a so-called zero-day exploit code, meaning it has been 0 days since this exploitation software was released to the world. Zero-day exploits are exceptionally rare and thus are typically seen only by advanced operators like nation-state actors. Also, for the same reason, those actors do not use them carelessly, since once they become public, they will get patched by the vendors and they can no longer provide covert access to computer systems. After the publication of this case by Qihoo 360 cybersecurity firm, this specific Flash 0-day got the unique identifier CVE-2018-15982, and it was classified as a use-after-free vulnerability in COM Adobe TV SDK Media Core Metadata Set Object. In layman's term, this means that due to a human error by Adobe, they did not use the correct controls when saving a value in set object. And although this memory space was freed, another part of the framework tried to use it, thinking it was something else. The exploit developers that discovered this were able to find this memory location and use it to trick the program into loading and executing code it shouldn't. They did it by tricking it into reading and running code that wasn't part of the legitimate program through this flaw. It's worth noting that among others, the exploit developers in this case also utilized a security bypassing method which became public in 2015 when the Italy-based intelligence firm Hacking Team was compromised and all their zero-day exploits were publicly leaked. Hacking Team was an Italian private company developing and selling zero-day exploits and backdoors to government agencies. Of course, this is an extremely simplified overview. In practice, they did some very innovative techniques to bypass several security layers that exist to protect systems against such exploitation. However, this hopefully gives you an idea of why zero-day exploits are typically used by advanced cyber operators. For the full technical details, please refer to the Qihoo 360's blog post. So this extracted file was the backdoor to let the cyber operators control the victim's computer. This backdoor was disguised as an NVIDIA control panel application named NVIDIA control panel.exe when loaded. First of all, this backdoor was checking if it's running on a malware analysis system, and if it was, it was automatically removing itself and erasing all the evidence of its execution. On the other hand, if that was a real victim system, it was monitoring for user activity like key presses or mouse movement. It was also collecting information from the system and contacting a command and control server to copy that data and also receive what to do next. Below the command control server icon here, you see the actual IP address used during that operation. It was from a rented server located in Romania. An innovative thing that this backdoor also had was a self-destruct mechanism. Occasionally, the backdoor would check the self-destruct time set by its operator, and if it was that time, it would remove itself and delete all evidence of its existence. The backdoor had several more features like bypassing the most widely used antivirus products, changing its behavior based on the security software installed, etc. And to ensure it will be able to persist even after the victim rebooted their system, it was using two methods. First, it was adding itself the fake NVIDIA application to automatically start when the system was starting, and secondly, if it found that some antivirus software was running, it was copying itself somewhere else, adding itself as a scheduled system task and wait for that to execute. Although unsuccessful, this modern cyber espionage operation gives a good idea of how intelligence collection is enabled by the cyber domain. It shows us the importance and value of zero-day exploits for cyber operators conducting those collection activities, but also how fragile those zero-day capabilities are. In this case, it was discovered and fixed by the vendor. More importantly, it's demonstrating how an unwitting victim clicking on an approval button in Microsoft Word could compromise sensitive medical systems, which could later be exploited to enable other clandestine operations. If that operation was successful, the only thing the targets could see could be the questionnaire opening up, they could potentially fill it in and send it back, and that's it. Everything else was happening covertly behind the scenes. Disguises changed from wigs to file names, dead drops from hollow rocks to internet-connected servers, bugs from covert microphones to software implants. But in all cases, the core principles of the espionage tradecraft remain the same. Nothing is as it seems.